On May 23, 1989, Karl Koch, a hacker from Hanover, Germany, was found dead in a forest. At the time of his death, he and his group already had been under investigation during several months by the German Secret Service, Bundesamt für Verfassungsschutz, and by the Federal Police Bundeskriminalamt. Since the early 1970s, Karl Koch's family experienced conflicts. Due to alcohol and domestic quarrel, the parents divided. The mother died in 1976 and the father in 1984, both of cancer. Karl Koch's father had been director of the local department of the newspaper Hannoversche Allgemeine Zeitung. That was possibly the reason for him having been placed on the BND's blacklist in the 1970s or even earlier, to be dealt with. As we see, both of Karl Koch's parents died from cancer after many years of problems on the personal level. With respect to the fact that Karl Koch had been persecuted during many years and then was murdered, this history certainly is not coincidental. According to experience, a covert persecution always is being conducted long before the open persecution. The aim is to isolate the targeted person. This includes, of course, destruction of the family. Karl had to stay down because of frequent absences from school. This was due to sleep disorder. With his heritage of 100,000 Deutschmarks, he began spending money fast. He was deprived of part of his heritage through consulting an independent child therapist during 9 months. As this was not covered by health insurance, he had to pay the bills. The sleep disorder quite obviously was the result of deliberate sleep deprivation through technical means, using directed energy to alter the brain waves. I myself experienced such sleep deprivation during many years, from the end of the 1970s till about the mid-1980s. It seems that my father already had been subjected to sleep deprivation in the early 1950s on certain occasions. A more violent variant is documented in my films Folter Nachts. During 1985, Karl Koch began to irregularly use cocaine because it was presented to him by a friendly software engineer. About the end of 1985, he regularly used the free cocaine. Since spring 1986, Karl Koch had to pay for the cocaine. This quickly drained his heritage. Now the friendly software engineer got back the money he had invested, like in the textbook. The friendly software engineer offered Karl Koch much money, or rather drugs, for data gained through hacking. In late summer of 1986, the hacker group for the first time supplied data to the KGB and was paid 30,000 Deutschmarks. Karl noticed being openly monitored. Later he learned from a journalist that he had been under surveillance by the Bundesnachrichtendienst, which even had a key for his flat. Around this time, Karl repeatedly attempted suicide. So the Bundesnachrichtendienst had been completely monitoring and openly persecuting Karl Koch since mid-1986 to exert pressure on him. If Karl Koch had been unstable enough to attempt suicide, the BND would have been able to easily keep him under control. But so we have to assume that these attempted suicides had been enforced by the BND to deliberately create a history of suicide attempts, to prepare for the murder of Karl Koch. Or that these suicide attempts already had been attempted murders by the BND. There is obvious proof for brainwashing technology having been used by the BND. The article Wie eine Wunderkerze states, his friends recall, there was this incident, he apparently wanted to bail out of a car going 180 kilometers per hour, because he believed that they, the Illuminati, just had uncovered him. Again, I myself have seen this many times in several persons being brainwashed. They were threatening to, or actually did, open the doors of a rolling car, or jumped out of the car at red traffic lights, shouting and screaming before calming down and getting back into the car again. Or the story about the endless computer session after which Karl Koch was sure that something big had blown up. A nuclear power plant or something. This was the day of the Chernobyl accident, before it became known to the public. Karl Koch could not have known about the Chernobyl accident before it was in the media. The only possible cause is transmission by the BND using brainwashing technology. I myself experienced a similar incident in connection with the 2005 bombings of the London Tube. About 6 to 7 days before the bombings, the BND was constantly repeating the name Leeds during about 5 hours. I've never experienced this before or afterwards. Then the bombings happened, and another 6 days later the police raided the terrorists' homes in Leeds. This occurrence does not only show that the BND knew that there was going to be a terrorist assault, but, most remarkably, that the terrorists were living in Leeds. In Alle großen Anarchisten starben am 23. it says, his friends remember him having been talking confusedly about aliens before he disappeared. But the news magazine Tempo reports about the preceding questioning through Verfassungsschutz und Bundeskriminalamt. Karl Koch appeared sound during the conversations. Karl Koch obviously had been submitted temporarily to the same brainwashing and steering technologies which had been documented in the cases of Anneliese Michel, Ulrike Meinhof and Jan-Karl Raspe, which are explained in my respective films. Concerning the deliberate isolation of Karl Koch before being assassinated, we read in Heute ist nichts Neues, das Alte ist traurig genug, published by the Chaos Computer Club. Koch was increasingly uprooted and isolated from his social surroundings during the following month. In the end, he even denied to talk to members of the Chaos Computer Club. Journalists having worked together with the Chaos Computer Club during years remained silent. Secretiveness, allegations and serious accusations became daily routine. Obviously, the journalists had been ordered by the administration of the German state to disconnect all contacts with Karl Koch. According to the publications, Karl Koch also was told to end all contacts with his friends. If such a pattern is recognized, one has to assume that the systematic isolation is conducted to prepare for a murder. This also was done in the case of my brother Markus Bott. He had been tortured openly during more than 5 years. In April and May 2009, he was tortured to leave our house and rent a flat in Karlsruhe. There he was assassinated 6 weeks later, on July 11th, 2009. The text Heute ist nichts Neues continues. Meanwhile, his friends made efforts to secure Koch's future living. He was given a job as an office help by the CDU of Lower Saxony. All persons involved were sworn to secrecy. German news magazine Der Spiegel first published Koch's name in connection with drug addiction and KGB activities in computer networks. This made any chance for a new start impossible. Interviewed by the Hamburger Abendblatt, journalists Bernd Sch and Axel L. braggily claimed to have uncovered the story. Thus, at least parts of the media had tried to make public the case of Karl Koch. He himself had stated that being known to many prevented the BND to murder him. Regrettably, he had not been sufficiently known. One reason was that publicity was hindered in an irresponsible way. Appropriate would have been to widely spread information. To make impossible Karl Koch being openly persecuted, tortured and murdered. In such a case, any news is good news. The text continues, the Chaos Computer Club and some responsible journalists tried to handle this story reasonably and protect Karl Koch from being marketed in public during the last month. Where this did not work out, they even deliberately hindered journalists being too inquisitive. This resulted in the accusation of damaging their reputation and being noxious to the profession. Photographs of Karl Koch were much sought after. Wherever possible, the publication was prevented by those who were able to judge the explosiveness of this issue. And this precisely did cost Karl Koch's life. Many were hindering the media right before the assassination of Karl Koch. He, in sharp contrast, was in contact with journalists and even planned to write a book together with one of them. You remember, Karl Koch was given a job as an office help by the Lower Saxony CDU. From April 24th to April 27th, 1989, he was questioned by the Bundeskriminalamt in Meckenheim. This was his last testimony. On May 22nd, 1989, Karl Koch moved into a flat in Hannover-Herrenhausen, paid for by the Verfassungsschutz. He was to quit his habitual environment. The next day, on May 23rd, 1989, Karl did not return from an official tour. Late on June 1st, 1989, Karl Koch's completely charred body was discovered in a wood near Ohof in the county of Gifhorn. Allegedly, he had dosed himself with gasoline and ignited it. The reason for the assassination. The KGB contact certainly was not the reason for the assassination of Karl Koch. This contact was made by Peter Karl. He took the suburban train to East Berlin, walked to the Soviet embassy and entered the building together with another visitor. There he introduced himself and requested to talk to a member of the KGB. This caused the Russians to laugh. After having regained their countenance, they took pictures of Peter Karl and recorded his statement on tape. Just like the BND is doing when they are openly persecuting someone. It seems that the Soviets put him under pressure to enable them to judge whether he was working for the BND. Later they arranged several meetings to hand over a few diskettes with data collected by the hackers. These meetings took place in the office of a Soviet trading company at Leipziger Straße No. 60. This must have been the only Soviet office in East Berlin visible from West Berlin. For example, from the Axel Springer building in Kreuzberg. This information always is being suppressed. The KGB obviously wanted the BND to see the meeting, as they were aware that the hackers had been under surveillance anyway, or even had been sent by the BND. Karl Koch was an intellectual being highly interested and competent in politics. As hacker, he only dialed into publicly accessible computers and occasionally caused some minor problems. Like how to charge 75 cents for the use of one of the computers. This caused him to be discovered. Karl's involvement in hacking covered the reasons for persecution. The reason for Karl Koch being put on the blacklist certainly was the preceding persecution of his family and his political consciousness and activities. He had been used by the BND to terrorize the computer community. As the BND says, nobody is so useless that he cannot serve as a daunting example. Around this time, the German state was very concerned with losing its propaganda monopoly due to the new computer networks. State agencies were brutally suppressing independent networks. On my homepage, you find some of the political texts Karl Koch had published in the computer nets. This made him one of the first, if not the first person, using the newly emerging computer nets as a tool to further political consciousness. Karl Koch had feared that one of the German secret services might murder him. This extract was taken from Karl Koch's text Die Abschaffung der Dummheit, The Abolishment of Dumbness. I am already too well known to have me violently eliminated. For the United States, this would only result in disastrous counter-propaganda and activation of viruses. The only state being interested in me disappearing is Germany. The news magazine Tempo reported the following statement of the farmer who had found Karl Koch's body. I do not believe in suicide, said the farmer Borsum, who had seen the crime scene. It was so dry that one match would have burned down the whole wood. And he is said to have used several liters of gasoline. There are other statements that the grass under Karkov's body was not burned, showing that he did not move while on fire. According to several sources, no shoes were found at the crime scene either. And it was said inconsistencies at the crime scene indicate that the dead body had been moved. This may lead to the conclusion that Koch died elsewhere and only was laid down there. An official of the Verfassungsschutz in Cologne, who had hunted Karl Koch, dubbed his death very, very strange in 1989. The news magazine Tempo gives the information, no suicide note, no statements, no hints. Everybody who knew him is stumped. Foreign secret services had no reason to assassinate Karl Koch. This was his own assessment too. The following statement from page 41 of the documentation about Karl Koch show that his intrusion was not seen as a real danger inside the US. The operators of the US computers tapped, watched and recorded the activities during several months. Then they notified Karl Koch and subsequently closed his illegal account. He was advised to refrain from intruding into US computers and told that efforts would be undertaken to locate him. An English computer operator was warned that he no longer would be supplied with hardware and software if he would not close down the account of the German hackers on his computer. The system manager informed Karl Koch and then closed his account. US operators were concerned with the correct operation of their systems, which is understandable as the hackers had announced to interfere with their systems. They had reacted in a reasonable way by blocking the illegal access. Following the spectacular hack, the NASA staff did not even change the passwords of their systems. This shows how serious or not serious they took the threat. The following information is also found in the news magazine Tempo. The SDI data was neither secret nor confidential. The Pentagon did not even react to the intrusion into their database. And the Milnet, run by the US military, is not allowed to hold secret material anyway. As we see, only publicly available material had been delivered to East Berlin. On www.totalitär.de, a more detailed version is given. Plus political texts by Karl Koch.